You're listening to Bedroom Beethovens, where notable music makers break down stories accompanied by songs and melodies documenting growth through their 10,000-hour journey. And me? Well, my name is Cello, your host.
I am a bedroom Beethoven.
Hey everybody, welcome to episode 97 of the podcast. My guest this week is...
My name is Ray Angry, also known as Mister Goldfinger. I'm a musician, I'm a pianist, I'm a composer, music producer, arranger, fitness aficionado, health nut. I work with bands like The Roots, work with Lauryn Hill, Queen Latifah, Mark Ronson. I've worked with Sting. There's a lot of people.
I did it all for the money, Lord. That's what it seems. Well, in the world of night terrors, it's hard to dream. They hollin' cash rules everything. Let's call it cream, because when it rises to the top, you get the finer things. Ocean fronts rolling blunts with model chickens saying grace over lobster steak. Like, please forgive us for riding business with camera plates. Too busy looking backwards for jackers to pump my brakes. For help sign to symbolize the lie that hunger takes. Addicted to the green, if I don't ball, I get the shakes. I give it all for a peace of mind, for heaven's sakes. My heart so heavy that the ropes that hold my casket breaks. Because everything that wasn't for me, I had to chase. They told me that.
Mr. Goldfinger, a.k.a. your favorite producer's favorite producer, a.k.a. Ray Angry, part of the legendary Roots crew at the helm of Producer Mondays, keyboardist, producer, songwriter, pianist, too many titles and talents to name on just a short intro like this, but I'm very honored to host the man for what can only be just short of an hour of gems pertaining to the journey, the 10,000-hour journey. If you like what I do, then let me tell you a little story. It started with a creative who loved music and wanted to fill a niche in the podcasting space where I bring in music producers and we don't talk about music production. Quite the novel idea. But here I am, 97 episodes later. And if you find yourself here listening, please head on over to patreon.com/bedroombeethovens where you can donate a buck or two to the show. And in turn, you help me out. Keep the show ad-free and you get some cool perks. And of course, I'm everywhere. YouTube, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and the website bedroombeethovens.com. All right, deep breath. If you're still here with me, subscribe to the channel, leave a 5-star review. It all contributes to the greater good. With that out of the way, I take you on a trip with Ray Angry from New York in 2001, working with Monster Albums through the 2000s through his latest work with Miss Coppola called Welcome to My Life, Don't Shoot. Not only is it a great song with some powerful visuals, but it's a great way to kickstart economic and social change, and there's a lot more on the way. Yeah, I know the old adage is work until you no longer have to introduce yourself. And I feel like if we had video, I wouldn't have to, but sadly, it's audio only.
Yeah, no, it's all good, man. It's all good, you know?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, before we got started, for me, it really is an honor to have you because amidst the COVID-19, this is kind of my podcast episodes go out on Wednesday. So this is my version of Producer Mondays, except this is like my Producer Wednesdays.
Nice.
Yeah, I mean, because I think about it, like, that's the formula for success, right, is to have, like, a collective. You know, you might like Stevie Wonder, but he was a part of Motown and Smokey and Diana, and anyone who has ever made it in music, they have a clique or an association. You know, Prince, he built his own clique. You know, Justin Timberlake was in a boy band. You know, The Roots got with Mos Def and Common and Dilla and Pharoah Monch, the Black Lily Sound Sessions. You had, you know, Jill Scott, Music Soul Child. You know, Jasmine Sullivan was like the daughter of one of the guys that hung out there, NDRE. So the list kind of goes on and on.
Mm-hmm. Like, no man is an island unto himself. You know, there's always a list of people that that is behind a person's success, whether you see them or you don't see them, you know? And I think that goes across all sorts of businesses, not only music, but any successful business, you know?
Rule number one, for sure. But and the key is, too, is like, you know, so once like D'Angelo goes platinum and Black Star goes platinum, now like the roots are celebrities, and then they're in a position to kind of pay it forward, which is rule number two.
Yeah.
Because I'm looking at it like it's been 3 decades in the business for you, Ray, and finally you released an album. You know, was it like you look around the room and was it like, you know, I've contributed to so many people. It's time to get a little selfish. You know, I was paying it forward first before trying to make it. So it's almost like you followed the blueprint backwards.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting because, you know, when I was first in love, when I first became in love with music, you know, I was just in love with being a part of any sort of band or any musical situation. I actually never saw myself, I never had the courage to like do my own music. You know, it was sort of like I was cool with being in the background, you know, and it's gone on for many years, you know. And also it's exciting, you know, when you're out of college and you're like wanting to be in the music industry and you start doing studio sessions and you start touring. It's fun, you know. But then when you're also a creative person and you write and you compose, those things sort of were yelling at me like, come on, man, let's go. I want to be free, you know. So all these songs that I, you know, that have been brewing in my mind just sort of came out, you know, when I was when I released my album. It was sort of like the perfect time. And all of those gigs and all of those experiences that I've had before really led to the sound of the album that I released, you know. And also, it also helped to have someone challenge you, you know. The record label, JMI, you know, Steve Mandel, he was, you know, I did a record for him. It was, I was recording as a sideman for the album of Steve Wilson. Steve Wilson is an exceptional musician, saxophonist, plays with everyone, you know, Chick Corea, you name it. And real legend in his own right. And I played on his album, and the producers were like, why don't you have your album? You know, why don't you record an album? And I was like, yeah, you know, I wasn't too crazy about the idea because I love being in the background. Once they, you know, sort of challenged me to make my own record, it just, I literally locked myself in my apartment and just wrote music for 3 months, and then recorded my album the third month, and recorded the whole album in 3 days.
Whoa, that's a furious pace.
Yeah, I'm always writing and always exploring different sounds, whether I'm producing jazz or if I'm working on something for a film. You know, I just love exploring sounds, and so I guess this part of my life, I'm becoming fearless in that regard and going after everything that I ever dreamed of and not being afraid to step out, you know. Like I recently, I think COVID changed everyone's life, but I think COVID also forced me to face the music in so many ways, you know what I mean? And just sort of face myself and see exactly what is it that you want? What is it you want to say musically? And so it just allowed me the time and to just study music, to write music, to you know, sort of center myself and focus and meditate and train and really delve deep into the inner source, inner part of who I am, to just sort of create the music that I've been creating. Like I've been writing music like crazy since COVID happened, you know, just like everyone else, I would imagine.
So, but you're also studying like literature outside of music to help you with your craft as well, right?
Yeah, man. I feel like I'm a student of life. You know, I'm studying orchestration. I'm always studying harmony. You know, studying the lives of composers who I really admire. You know, I love classical music. You know, and I also love jazz and I also love hip hop. So for me, my musical palette is a combination of all those different things. So I've been delving deep into those genres and figuring out what my sound is in all of those genres and sort of, you know, how can I make this a delicious meal for someone to digest, you know what I mean, that want to experience something that's a little bit of everything, you know? And I feel like I'm not just one thing. I feel like, you know, I've played with so many different people and so many different bands and so many different genres that, you know, I sort of move between genres, you know, and I just love that musical bending, you know, which is why I love the Producer Monday event that I started, because it was sort of, I wanted to bring together folks from different genres. I mean, people have jam sessions all the time, you know, but I wanted to create something where musicians from all genres got together and actually vibed out, you know what I mean? And sort of created this community. So that's where I'm moving musically, is to sort of create this universal gumbo where people are just sort of really creating together in new ways and maybe even changing the sound of music, you know, where it's more, you know, it's not just, you know, the top 40 sound of the day. Everyone is mimicking that sound, where people are more brave and creating their own sound and being cool with that.
Do you recall a book by John C. Maxwell called The 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Well, what you just said kind of goes with what he just said, because Dr. Maxwell says that if you're taking a walk in the forest and no one's following, you're merely taking a stroll. So if you're making an album and no one hears it, or it only sells 10,000 copies instead of going platinum, does that diminish the accomplishment in terms of being a leader?
Mm.
Because he defined leadership as influence, nothing more, nothing less. Yeah. So, you know, is Prince a musical leader because he sold 100 million copies, or because he released 39 studio albums? Or is he a leader because of how he recorded those albums?
Yeah, that's a very good point, because, you know, the ego musically, you know, the ego itself can be fed various ways. You know, it could be like, you know, like you were saying, you know, you can get all these accolades, but is it really changing someone's life? You know, so I essentially, you know, I really want to use music as a tool to really change people's lives and have people be fearless, you know?
Yeah. So, and you were in Sear studio the other day, and Mr. Sear wrote a book in the late 90s. It was a 6-part critique of the music industry called What Have They Done to My Art? Did you know about that?
I didn't know that. I don't know about that book.
Yeah. I haven't read it myself, but I was fascinated by his life, because he was a tubist, and he invented a new kind of valve for the tuba, and got a factory in Belgium to manufacture these new tubas. And he was able to do that because before he had a studio, he went to college and he got a degree in mechanical and electrical engineering, but he couldn't find a job because he was Jewish.
Wow. That's interesting. I never knew that.
Yeah. So it's almost like he started that studio out of necessity. And, you know, I think Bjork and Mark Ronson and you and everyone's been in there.
Oh my God. First of all, let me tell you something. That studio, Sears Sound, is a very, you know, I've worked in some amazing studios, even Abbey Road, you know, and like there's something about being in a space that's so sacred, like a studio space where you have so many, you know, different artists and producers who just sort of bless the space with their creativity. And Sears Sound is, man, that place is magical. And I'm not surprised that he created. And see, that's what I'm saying. Like, you know, it's like you use your gift to create something that blesses people. Like, you know, I'm pretty sure he was thrilled to know that he created something that so many people were blessed by. That studio is amazing. You know, I love working there.
Well, let me talk about like another very accomplished person, your father. You're a junior, correct? And he was a Vietnam vet. He was in the Marines. You know, already alone with that description, he sounded like a guy you didn't want to mess with.
Yeah, you know, the thing is, my dad, I'm doing music right now because my father, he saw something in me. You know, I used to mess around on the piano after church. And my father was, man, he was my biggest cheerleader. I mean, he really put me in position to develop musically. I mean, he believed in me when I didn't believe in myself, you know, and that was the beauty of my father. He definitely, you know, took me to recitals. I remember one time, I think Reggie Jackson was running for president anyway, and I was like 14 or 12 years old, and I actually played at his event that when he came down to Florida. It was a huge, you know, political event, you know, sort of like what's happening now. You know, everyone is like out voting, and you know, this guy was trying to become president, and I was invited to perform at this big gala, you know, and I was like, I must have been 12 or 11, you know, and it was a big honor. But my dad, you know, he pushed me to perform and to really do my best. And I'm so grateful for all of the life lessons he instilled in me.
Yeah, because I'm reading like your mom was an educator and your dad had the work ethic of a Marine and he believed in you. So yeah, of course you went to Howard. Of course you're a Howard alum. It makes fundamental sense.
Oh man, that was the best experience ever. Yeah, when I went to Howard, man, I really got a chance to meet some great teachers, great friends. I was studying with Grady Tate and Geri Allen, all of these jazz legends. And actually met Wynton Marsalis, you know, when I was in school. Like, he would always play at Blues Alley. So I was there every year when he would play Blues Alley for like a week, you know, and I was there every night, you know. And to experience that was just life-changing, you know, being around those kinds of people. I was a part of the Thelonious Monk Institute. They used to always perform, have students performing at the White House. And so it was a blessing to be a part of that, you know, of these great institutions like New World School of the Arts, where, you know, where I went to high school. You had these amazing programs with, you had teachers who were also working in the arts, but also were giving you the tools that you needed for when you got out of school and you wanted to, you know, be a performer. You know, like everyone that's gone to my high school is doing something amazing, or even everyone that I went to college with, they're all doing amazing things. So it's really great to have experienced though that type of education growing up, you know?
Yeah, I love that, because growing up as a kid myself, everyone told me that the Cosby Show was unrealistic, but your dad was a doctor and your mom was a doctor. You were living that life.
Yeah. Well, my mom became a doctor after all of her kids grew up, you know? And so once we were out of the house, you know, then she went back to school. And, you know, and the thing about my parents, you know, one thing that I love about them is they never stopped growing. You know, my father was, you know, I remember when he got his bachelor's, and then I remember when he got his master's, then he got his specialist degree, then he was like, I'm going to get my doctorate. And then he inspired my mother to get her doctorate. And so, you know, here they are in the latter part of their life, still growing and still learning and still, you know what I mean, trying to become the best version of themselves. So I guess in a sense, that's what I'm doing, you know?
Well, I hope you still go eat at Cracker Barrel from time to time.
Well, that's changed significantly, but I do have fond memories of being there with my dad, you know, especially when I would come home from college and I would surprise him. That was the place we would go. We'd go to Cracker Barrel. We would talk about school, talk about life, you know? Yeah. Oh my God, Cracker Barrel. Woo! Memories. Now that I'm vegan, it's like, No. All I can have there is water and tea.
You know? Oh man. Well, as someone who's had like many relationships in music, you know, I know you're a jazz lover. In all the relationships you made, I was really surprised that Adrian Young beat you to that jazz label thing, because like you once said, the people who are at the helm of music don't know anything about music. So you take someone like Adrian Young and you get Roy Ayers and Tony Allen and Lonnie Liston Smith and you package it up for a new audience. It just kind of made sense.
Being in the moment, I think that's the most important thing, is to really appreciate now. You know what I mean? Like, even this conversation, it's very important to be present, because tomorrow isn't promised, you know? And I think it's very important to pay homage to those that came before us.
Not only that is that too. That's very important. But I would like to see a paradigm shift, because you have people like John Janik and Jimmy Iovine and Lucian Grange and heads of these giant labels, and their thinking is, well, a new Ariana Grande record is going to outsell 100 Herbie Hancock albums right now. That's the thinking. So I'm glad that there are people like you, there's people like Adrian, who are in positions to cultivate, mentor, and extend your musicality to the masses, other than label heads and suburban white guys who just look at data sheets all day, you know?
Yeah, you know, that's a very interesting point that you make, because I think the whole system just needs to be, you know, there needs to be a clean slate, because the whole system is ass backwards, you know, in my opinion. When you're trying to sell records, you know, you're sort of a slave to people's taste, and, you know, and then there's marketing. So there's a lot that goes into that. So I kind of get the record labels, you know, their thinking, but also, you know, I don't know, man, it's a tough one, you know, because people, they love what they love. Some people love Ariana Grande, and there's nothing wrong with that. And some people don't know who Herbie Hancock is, but I think when you change the educational system and you allow kids to grow up with a variety of music that they're learning in school, the music industry will change, you know. But I think it's changing, you know. I think sports is changing, everything is changing before our eyes. But, you know, the record industry is a beast in and of itself. That's been, you know, it's been the same way for hundreds, you know, for decades, you know what I mean? And it's a shame that artists don't really get the recognition that they deserve, you know. Like Marvin Gaye never won a Grammy.
James Brown never had a number one hit.
Come on. You know, it's a rigged system to some degree. You know what I mean? Because if you have a monopoly over the marketing, because if people don't know about it, they can't buy it. You know what I mean? It's a lot of things that need to be changed, you know. And it's really sad that artists are sort of slaves to the industry, and they can't really, you know, like, you think about all the great singers that are like heroes in their hometowns, but they never get a chance to really be heard, because maybe they don't have the right manager. Maybe, you know, there's so many reasons that go into that. But I am positive things will change, you know. Maybe, you know, we'll get a new blood into the White House, and the whole system will change. But I definitely feel like there needs to be, the music industry in and of itself needs to be sort of revamped on all accounts.
I agree. Because, you know, if you have someone like Prince who invites Clive Davis over his house, they're just going to talk business. But if he invites you over his house, you guys can swap stories into the wee hours of the night, because there's that bond of music. And I think real business opportunities can grow to something like that.
You know, I would love to be in a room with a Clive Davis, you know, talking about music and business, because, you know, some guys, man, you know, some, not all record labels are, label heads are bad. You know, there's some great guys like Steve Greenberg, who's over at S-Curve Records, you know, like, this guy loves music. I've been working with him for the past 20 years. And the things that he's done is amazing. And I just wish that other artists had a chance to sort of experience being with a really good person with good ethics that also loves music. And I think that's the thing. You know, music is so dirty, and it's so grimy, and there's so many different aspects of it. You know, I don't know. I just hope that the business and the music can marry together in a way that's ethical, and a way that everyone sort of is winning. You know what I mean? Like, I feel like we all can win, is my point.
Well, have you been consciously distancing yourself from rap? Because, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the last rap album that you worked on, like the core rap album, was The Stoned Immaculate.
Oh, wow. No, I mean, listen, I love all types of music, and I feel like I'm actually trying to figure out a way to bring worlds together in a very interesting way, because I feel like everything is really connected, even though it might not seem so. But, you know, I don't know. I mean, I work with The Roots. I mean, you know, Black Thought is one of the greatest MCs alive. So I don't think that I'm shying away from, you know, whatever, you know, rap music. I don't really call it rap. I mean, I think it's just music, you know. It's spoken word, it's poetry. It's about expressing yourself. So I think people should be able to express themselves however they want to, because, you know, not everyone has a silver, you know, grows up with a mom and a dad. Some people grow in very fucked up environments, and the way that they think is a result of that environment. So I think it's important to hear, for everyone to be heard. But I also think that it's important for people to have the same type of opportunities and access to things that will make them better.
Does that POV get mucked up when you get a lot of commercial success? Because 2006 was a monster year from you. You worked on just two albums, or Christina Aguilera and Mobb Deep. Those two albums sold 6 million albums combined. You know, and then you had marketing dollars behind it. So, you know, Nate Dogg, Dre, Alchemist, Mary J, DJ Premier, they were all on that. Can you still have that mature clarity when so much commercial success is headed your way year after year?
I didn't get all of that success. I mean, those artists did. But, you know, I think I would think, yes, why not? You know, I think you can still make a lot of money and still do a lot of good. You know, I just don't buy this. You have to be a starving artist. Like, fuck that. When people work together, we started off the conversation talking about community. In my mind, if you can imagine, like, if you had the most amazing artists that, you know, who's doing great numbers, you know, imagine them, you know, not imagine them working with unknown artists and really cultivating like a movement, you know what I mean? Where it's not just about the numbers, where it's just about community. In that regard, I think we all can win and you can still have commercial success. But I just feel like that opportunity isn't always there because, you know, marketing, the labels, there's so many restrictions on who artists can work with because a record label may not want their artists working with a certain person because of branding, or that's off brand. So there's so many aspects to music that, you know what I mean? But I would love to think that you can have commercial success and still say something. And I remember one time I was working with this artist, and his manager was he gave me a great lesson. He was trying to sign me. He was like, man, I respect your talent, but no disrespect, fuck your talent. It's the music business. You know, it's the music business. It's not just music, you know, it's business, you know? And so which has sort of a form of capitalism to it. You know, when you're an artist and you like, you know, you're a big name, you got to keep that big name. So you might not pay your people really well. You know what I mean? This is a tough cookie to crack, man.
Let me get your take on this unique situation. In 2006, I mentioned that Christina Aguilera album, Back to Basics. She had an interlude track on there called Fuss, which stood for Fuck You, Scott Storch. Scott Storch was Aguilera's former producer and contributed to her previous album. He refused to produce Back to Basics, and that decision changed her perception about him. That's scary, because on her next album, she might say, hey, Ray, I want you to play the clavinet on this track. And if you refuse, there might be an interlude on that album called Fura or something. You know, it's like, I didn't know you were allowed to do that.
I think it's a little bit deeper than that. I don't think it's just that black and white. I don't know that story. You know, I don't know Scott Storch at all, but I know he's had quite an incredible career, you know. I mean, he's definitely been to the mountaintop because he's had some great success. So I'm pretty sure there's a lot more to that story, but I don't know, you know, I didn't even know that was on the record, you know?
Yeah. I only bring it up because, you know, not a lot of people don't know that Scott Storch was kind of a quasi member of the Roots back in the day, but I always have to.
Quasi? Yeah. He was a member of the Roots. You know, I mean, the Roots family tree is wide and deep, you know? There's so many people that have, you know, been a part of that. So many different artists, and I think it's almost like like you're in a college or something, you know what I mean? And then you're like a HBCU, you know, like you have some famous black college, you know, because there's so many great artists that have come through that the Roots camp. But yeah, Scott Storch, definitely. I don't know his full story, but I do know that he started off with the Roots. And the Roots manager, Richard Nichols, who I would like to think of as one of my mentors, he was like a great thinker and also artistic director for all of the Roots albums, you know, until he passed away. And I'm pretty sure that, you know, he had a great way of sort of guiding you, you know what I mean, musically. And I'm pretty sure he was very instrumental in Scott Storch's development, you know what I mean? Because he just knew talent, you know?
Yeah, and you know, some of my favorite work from yours has come out of that. You know, there's a record which is a tale in reverse about the day in the life of Redford Stevens, and I'm talking about Undone. Love that record.
Oh, my God. You know what's crazy? I was like, you know, I wanted to get a plaque. I wanted to get a plaque of that album and a couple other albums that I'm on. And then I just realized that I was like, yeah, I just want to get a, you know, I called up, I think it was RIAA, which is, they do like all of the, they sort of calculate all the sales for records, you know? And so record labels, when you want a plaque made, you have to, you know, you go to them and they make the plaque, but they have a deal with the record labels. And I wanted to get a plaque made, and they were like, oh no, you can't do it. You have to get permission to get a plaque made for a record that you're on. You have to get permission. And I was like, that's fucked up. You know, I don't know how many records I'm on with the Roots, but it's from 2008 to now. I'm on all those albums. So I wanted to get like, you know, a plaque with me on showing that I worked on these records. And it's probably like 10 records or 7. Anyway, I love that Undone. I love that album, man. You know, and I really got a chance to be on there as a composer, you know, because I did the string quartets on that, wrote for strings on that record, you know? That was a great experience.
That was a concept album though. Is that theme laid out for you before you start composing?
So that goes back to the genius of Richard Nichols. You know, Richard Nichols, he was ahead of his time. You know, every Roots album, there was always a theme or some sort of intellectual thought behind each record. They don't just make records to just make records, you know, which is why you have someone like Black Thought, who's just fucking brilliant, you know what I mean? And Questlove, who's able to, like, you know, they're able to sort of work with all sorts of people because of this sort of intellectual look at music. You know, they're not just playing their instruments. You know, Black Thought isn't just rhyming. Like he's digesting literature. He's digesting what's going on in the world and speaking on it. And the same with Questlove. Like this guy's, he's like an encyclopedia. You know, this guy knows records. You know, he knows about things that most people don't even think about. You know, he knows stories about the Root, about Prince, about, you know what I mean, Earth, Wind & Fire, Stevie Wonder, you know what I mean? So this sort of intellectual look at music, I think, goes to, speaks to how they make records. You know, there's always a theme for each album. And, you know, Things Fall Apart. You know, that's a fucking great record, which we performed at the Hollywood Bowl. That was a great gig. That was one of my favorite gigs with the Roots.
So like you just said, like, you know, Black Thought isn't just going to rhyme. There's going to be some craftsmanship involved to tailor to the song. You worked, like I mentioned it, you worked with Kari Martin. Funny enough, he's kind of moved away from traditional music and he's been filming scores for the past few years. And I know that one of your dream projects was to work on film scores with your Howard alum, Chadwick Boseman. So I wanted to kind of put you on the spot here, mm-hmm. because I know another dream of yours was to work on a Martin Scorsese film. His next film is called Killers of a Flower Moon. It's very, very early in production, and if production has even started at all. Now, the plot is members of the Osage tribe in the United States are murdered under mysterious circumstances in the 1920s, sparking a major FBI investigation involving J. Edgar Hoover. So you get a phone call, you know, your phone rings. Ray, it's Martin. I have this film. It takes place in the roaring 20s, and it involves a scandal involving J. Edgar Hoover. How do you approach that project? What would it sound like?
It would be a period piece, obviously. You know, I mean, the music, I think it would be cool to blend the music from the 1930s with modern elements, if that makes any sense.
I think so, kind of like the American Gangster approach a little bit.
A little bit, but different. Because, you know, the 1930s, you know, you had the roaring big bands. I mean, that was the sound of the day. You know what I mean? Meshing that with just modern sounds, you know, would be kind of interesting, I think. I've always been interested in blending worlds together. So that would be one of my approaches. And then also, I think the most important would be to understand what his vision is for the film and how he wants the film to feel. Because I think essentially when you're composing for film, it's about the emotion and capturing that emotion and you know what I mean, and telling a story musically. So I think that would be the most important thing, is to sort of understand what is the lyrical bed, or what's the harmonic bed behind this story, you know, that helps, you know, bring the story to life.
I'm putting that out in the universe. You know, you may not be getting your plaques for the Roots albums, but I'm going to get you an Academy Award for Best Soundtrack working with Martin Scorsese. Let's make that happen.
Oh, man, I appreciate you for that. I would love to do that. I mean, yeah, you know, I've come to realize that all of these musical experiences that I've had, the best place I think that my music lives is in film, you know, because I'm just, you know, all over the place musically. And sometimes that's not top 40, you know, but it's almost like a movie. You know, I remember Kanye was in a studio once, and he was talking about how he wanted his music to feel like it's a movie. And I think this was in his early years as a producer before he became Yeezy, you know. And that always resonated with me, you know. I love film. I love orchestration. I love making beats. I love working with amazing singers. I love working with intellectuals. I love just working with people who are just really trying to push humanity to a whole different plateau, you know what I mean, of enlightenment. And I just love telling stories through music and with visuals, you know.
I got that vibe when I was watching Welcome to My Life, Don't Shoot. Like, it kind of plays out like a movie.
Yeah, that's how it started. That's how it started, man. That's how it started. You know, when COVID hit, man, I was so depressed, man. I was like, man, the world is over. I stopped working out. I stopped eating right. And, you know, I was glued to the TV, and then something happened. And actually, guys, I got sick. I think I had COVID. I got so sick, I felt like I was going to die. And all of that hit me at once. And then something happened to me where I can't remember exactly what happened, but something inside of me was like, fuck this shit. I'm going to fucking live, and I'm going to be the best version of myself. And I'm going to, like, just do everything I ever dreamed I'm going to do, even if the world is burning. And that's the attitude I took, which is how that single got released that I just released, Welcome to My Life, Don't Shoot, because I was so inspired by what was going on. And, you know, and I wrote a song called The Protest. I saw after George Floyd passed away, there was so much social unrest happening in New York City and around the world. I went to a protest and saw a police car burning, and man, that fucked my head up. And I went home and just wrote a piece and played live on Instagram, and that became The Protest. And so out of that became this relationship with TL to create this story about America in a way people are transformed from seeing the film by using images and using music as a way to sort of get people to I mean, everyone has biases, but we can all learn to live together and not hate each other. You know what I mean? So I don't know. That's how that happened. So I was really inspired, and I'm still inspired, and I really want to. If this is my last time on Earth, if this is my last hour, I want to give it my. I want to give it 150%, and just be that passionate and that disciplined and that and just having that sort of fire for greatness. And you know, for me, you know, I want to work with my idols, and it's crazy because my life is crazy. I've actually worked with everybody whose records I was listening to when I was 18, and I was like, oh man, you know, listening to Common's album, like Water for Chocolate, you know, listening to The Roots, you know what I mean? Listening to D'Angelo, listening to Wynton Marsalis, Richard Smallwood, Yolanda Adams, all these people, Sting, you know, and all these people whose records I was digesting when I was like 18 and as a freshman in college, man, I've worked with them. You know, I'll be in LA at Equinox working out and I'll see Common, like, you know what I mean? Like, hey, what's up, man? You know, so it's like, you know, it's weird, man. So, you know, I just believe in the power of manifestation. I believe in people believing in themselves and believing that anything is possible. And if you have an idea, don't let some idiot tell you can't do it. You know, I think that was a quote from Stan Lee, you know, and I think it's very important that creatives stay creative and don't let the label heads who only see numbers tell you, you know, you're garbage. I mean, they even told Jay-Z he was garbage. And look at where Jay-Z is now. You know, they wouldn't even play his record. There's something to be said when someone actually believes in themselves. You know, I remember I was in the studio. My man Bink, great producer, invited me to Vegas to work with him on the album of Dr. Dre. Dr. Dre was working on his record, and I'll never forget this experience. It was like New Year's Day. And I got a phone call, hey, can you come to Vegas to work with Dr. Dre? I was like, hell yeah. And I left that night to go to Vegas to work with Dre. And the thing about Dre that I appreciate is that he really was about, man, people don't know how powerful the mind is. If you think you can't do something, then you won't be able to do it, you know? And he was just, that's the thing that I got from that session, you know? It's just that, man, just really believe in what you're doing and it'll come to pass, you know? And I think a lot of times people get discouraged because you'll have an idol who may not be that nice to you. You know, you might idolize someone, they're not nice to you, and then all of a sudden you like, you hate this person, then you develop, and then all of a sudden you get good, and then they're like, oh, hey, man, you know? And then, but, you know, I just feel like, you know, you shouldn't let people discourage you is my point, you know, because it happens all the time. People will, if you're not killing it, people will look down on you, you know? And then you have to use that pain and that energy to really fight and go after what you want. And then ultimately you'll get it. And then you'll be that person for someone else who wants to come up, you know? So I feel like, you know, don't shit on people on your way up, because you got to meet the motherfuckers on your way down.
Well, I'm happy to report that you are a pleasure to talk to, and your ego is definitely not getting in the way. I appreciate it.
Thank you, man. This has been a pleasure, man. Thank you for doing this. This has been very inspiring for me, you know?
Yeah, I'm probably just a shell of an interviewer and a long line of people you've talked to, but fostering meaningful relationships and doing work that matters to me is a big part of why I do this show. So the door is always open for you to return to the podcast. It's been a pleasure to speak with you, and I hope you continue to bless us with your music moving forward.
Thank you, man. I appreciate this.
I'm going to leave you with this. In the mortal words of Dr. Ray Angry Sr., leave the nest, do your best, and
forget the rest.
Boom.
Wow, you nailed it, man. That was my father told me that when I was leaving the house, when I was leaving the home going to college. Those were his words to me. Wow.